Thank you. bless you, saints. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Let's sing number 39, The Goodness of Jesus, in the key of F. Just a short course to begin the service.
When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he has done for me, then my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise God for saving me. Oh, one more time. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he has done for me, then my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise God for saving me.
Number 514, key of G. Key of G.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, I'm standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail, when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, I'm standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I now can see, perfect present cleansing in the blood for me. Standing in the liberty where Christ makes free, I'm standing on the promises of God. I'm standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. And standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. I'm standing on the promises of God. I'm standing, standing, standing on the promises of my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. I'm standing on the promises of God. I'm standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
Number 482, This Is Like Heaven to Me, in the key of F.
We find many people who can't understand why we are so happy and free. We've crossed over Jordan to Canaan's fair land, and this is like heaven to me. Oh, this is like heaven to me. Yes, this is like heaven to me. I've crossed over Jordan to Canaan's fair land, and this is like heaven to me. So when we are happy, we sing and we shout. Some don't understand us, you see. We're filled with the Spirit, there is not a doubt. And this is like heaven to me. This is like heaven to me. Yes, this is like heaven to me. I've crossed over Jordan to Canaan's fair land, and this is like heaven to me. We've heard the sweet music, the heavenly chord, from glory land over the sea. So from Jesus our Lord, and this is like heaven to me. Oh, this is like heaven to me. Yes, this is like heaven to me. I've crossed over Jordan to Canaan's fair land, and this is like heaven to me. Let's sing that one more time. Oh, this is like heaven to me. Yes, this is like heaven to me. I've crossed over Jordan to Canaan's fair land, and this is like heaven to me.
Amen. Maybe we can stand together, sing number 771, also an F.
I feel the touch of hands so warm and tender. They're leading me through paths that I must trod. I'll have no fear, for Jesus walks beside me. For I'm sheltered in the arms of God. So let the storms rage high, the dark clouds rise, they won't worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and naught on earth can harm me. Sheltered in the arms of God, soon I shall hear the call from heaven's portals. Come home, my child, it's the last mile you must trod. I will be changed and taken to God's new heaven. For I'm sheltered in the arms of God. So let the storms rage high, the dark clouds rise, they won't worry me, sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and naught on earth can harm me. For I'm sheltered in the arms of God.
Let's sing verse number 2 again.
Soon I shall hear the call from heaven's portals. Come home, my child. It's the last mile you must draw. I will be changed and taken to God's new heaven. Sheltered in the arms of God. So let the storms rage high, the dark clouds rise. They won't worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and naught on earth can harm me. For I'm sheltered in the arms of God.
Amen. Believe that tonight. I'll ask Brother Ivan if you can take a few prayer requests we have for Sister Marianne Hofer for healing, and also Brother Tim and Sister Marianne's daughter Hannah also for healing. And there are many missing tonight, some traveling, some working. We'll just remember them in prayer as well. Just pray for the service as well, Brother Ivan.
God bless you, saints. Let's just take these Lord needs to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just bow before you, Lord. Father, thankful, Lord, for once again, Lord, be in your presence, Lord, and come to this place with saints of like precious faith, Lord. Father, to hear your word, Lord. Father, we just ask, Lord, that you just bless the service, Lord. Bless Brother Paul as he brings the word. Father, and Father, we're so thankful, Lord, for the middle of this week, Lord. We might be tired and weary, Lord, but we just pray, Lord, that you just push every hindering spirit away, Lord, and just speak to our hearts. Father, and these needs that were read here, Lord, the different ones, Lord, those that aren't with us, those that are traveling, Lord, we just ask, Lord, that you just be their portion wherever they would be, Lord. Father, and Sister Miriam, Father, the stroke, I believe. Father, you are perfect, Lord, and Father, we just ask, Lord, that you just come on the scene and touch her. Father, and Father, just remove those symptoms, and Father, just give her a complete healing, Lord, and we just stand on your word, Father. Father, and the different ones, Lord, if I forgot any, Lord, just thinking of our brother Prashant and sister Akansha, Lord. Lord, we just ask, Lord, that you just be their portion there. We didn't see Sister Sue tonight, Lord. We just, Father, just pray, Lord, that you just be with her, Lord, and the family, and just give her strength. And Father, we just give this service into your hands, Lord, and just pray for a blessing in the tithes and offerings, Lord, that would be used for the furtherance of your kingdom. Father, we just give this service into your hands and ask all these things in your precious name, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Ivan. You may be seated. We have a special, and we'll just need a second to get it set up.
should sit with our heads hung down. God is with us now, giving strength to the bride's shape, since the true way she's found. And the manifest signs of God, this one surely will see. So good to me. The living word made flesh again and revealed to me. I was blind and I could not see till Jesus found me. Then I rose up to praise the Lord for all his mercies to me. Then I rose up to praise the Lord.
Yeah, I wanted to sing that song as a congregational once, so maybe now we can, that we've heard it. So we closer to the preaching of the word. Let's sing number 122. This song is a little new to me, but I'm hoping a lot of you will know it. It's in our songbook. That's always my excuse.
All he wants is you. All of your heart, all he wants is all of you, all he wants is you, all he wants is me. Unreservedly, not just a part, he wants all of your heart. All he wants is all of me. All he wants is me.
Let's stand and sing together.
All he wants is you. No one else will do. Not just a part, he wants all of your heart. All he wants is all of you. All he wants is you.
All he wants is me.
Oh, all he wants is me. Unreservedly, just a part. He wants all of my heart. All he wants
is just. Isn't it beautiful to know how much our Lord Jesus wants us, yes, desires us? You know, when you read the word and take the prophet's words, you know, it's so wonderful when you just really catch the revelation of how much he loves our souls, how that our souls are so important that he even would die for us. And to me, it's just incredible. And I'm happy to be a part of this. Amen. Amen. We just definitely want to lift up Sister Hofer, Sister Marianne Hofer. Just a very difficult situation. And I guess maybe I would go ahead and say it. I don't know. The doctors, you know, are mentioning things like being a vegetable. And we just don't want to settle for that. Amen. We're not called to settle for that. Right. Amen. And I know that our sister had expressed as best she could in the last couple days that she would just be happy if the Lord would take her home. You know, and that's not, I just know our sister Marianne, it's not an escape route. It's just a hunger to be in his presence, a desire to be in his presence. I just want to speak to you this evening. Thank you, musicians, and a beautiful song service. Amen. I want to speak to you this evening on an extension of him. And that is what I had a quote Sister Jerry actually shared with me that I felt to save that maybe for just a bigger picture. But, you know, when we just realize how important it is not just to say that we're Christians, but to be the magnification or the manifestation of Jesus Christ in this day. We'll read scripture and I'll let you be seated. And then I want to just share a little something with you. Romans 8 and 4 through 11, and we'll just take this thought tonight for just a few minutes. It come out to me in a very interesting way, and I just trust that I can share that inspiration that I received with you tonight. Amen. Romans 8 and 4. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Amen. And we could take this and just draw in the thought of what we say in a marriage vow, for richer, for poorer, sickness and in health. None of this matters. We're not here to walk after the flesh, but to walk in the Spirit. Amen. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Amen. If any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, Amen. The body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Right. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies Amen. By his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, bless the reading of your word and the preaching of your word tonight. Lord, the many needs and requests of those, Brother Trevor, Sister Carrie, Lord, and each and every one, Brother Pershonton and Sister Concha, our Sister April, Father, each and every one, maybe we miss some, Father, our Sister Sue and others, Lord, just ask you to be with them tonight. Just speak to hearts, Father, no matter where the bride is, Lord, that we can just come a little closer today, Father, and a little closer, Lord, will bring us right into the door and take a rapture, Father. Amen. We thank you, amen, Father, for this opportunity, amen, tonight. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Lord. You may be seated. Amen. Now, I want to just kind of deviate for just a moment. So, Brother David would be very aware of this, but there was a brother that used to be fellowshipped with Brother David in Arizona. Brother David was his pastor, our brother Dace Hyatt, and his wife Michelle and daughter Mia. I just had a lovely conversation with him in the last couple days back and forth, and just a lovely time. And a little later here, the reason I kind of bring this up is I want to share a little something he shared with me today. And I hope that, did he share that with you, Brother David? Oh, well, okay.
He didn't share what you said.
Okay. But just a lovely little thought, very brief, but it just really drove home to me. And I actually got very excited about it and kind of put what I was thinking about over on the side just to kind of touch on that tonight. And so as we'll look at this, my brother and sister, we'll see that this ability to walk in the flesh is actually, to not walk in the flesh, but to walk in the spirit, is actually a gift of God. It is not something that we in our humanity can do on our own. It's an age that we live in. The spirits are so strong. And I think sometimes we fail to recognize that because the Holy Spirit buffers the spirits around us. And, I could go into a long discourse on agronomy, but sometimes when you are have certain circumstances you need to be able to get a seed germinated, sometimes you'll actually add things to the soil right where you're going to plant so that it buffers the pH or buffers the alkaline or the acid so that you can actually get the seed to grow. And once the seed is growing, it can handle the environment that it's in, but it needs to get a start to grow. And so we'll look how the Holy Spirit has come down in our lives. I think each one of us can go back through our lives and realize at the time that the Holy Spirit come and totally buffered the environment around us and give us that chance to get our roots down and to start growing. And it's a very crucial time, you know, right there at the time of germination. And we'll see how that God would come and do that. And the gift that he has given to us, we see that to be carnally minded is death, but to be spirit, to be filled with the Spirit or spiritually minded is life and peace. And God gets that anchor. And what keeps pulling us back, my brother and sister, is the Holy Spirit. It is the age that we live in that Satan would try to buffet us on every hand. And you know, you look at this and little things bother you. And if not careful, or the Holy Spirit not there present with us, Satan would just love to get one little fingernail inside our life. Amen. You know, I don't know if you guys ever in the natural had a cat climb on your screen door, right? Amen. We've had some cats that liked screen doors. They seem to like to do that. And you know, what the cat's doing is knowing that if I can just get them to open the door for me, I get to go inside. And Satan knows the same thing. He's out there scratching on the door, trying to just get the opportunity to come in. But God has come. Amen. We're not in the flesh. We don't live in the flesh. We're not going to dwell in the flesh. We can't overcome in the flesh. Amen. The flesh is overcome when we are in the Spirit. Amen. Otherwise, if we just try to reform ourselves to be good people, it will last for a season. It will last for a moment. But as it is in verse 8, amen, those that are in the flesh cannot please God. It's not even an option. Amen. But we are not in the flesh. I like verse 9. We're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. And if so be the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. And if Christ be in you, your body is dead because of sin, But the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Amen. And so we'll look at this. I want to catch verse 11 before we move on. But if the Spirit of Him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit that dwelleth in you. Amen. And as we'll look, and I'm going to hold you in a bit of a mystery till we come to the end of this. But my brother and sister, for us to resonate with the Word of God, if we are going to have the same nature, the same desires, the same abilities, then we must be of the same substance. In other words, you cannot take and have two different materials bring forth the same sound. You cannot take and have the Spirit of life resonating against something that is dead and bring forth the sound of life. And so it is there that is the Word of God. You musicians would certainly understand that. You've got to bring things, if you want it to be equal sound, it has to be brought in an equal fashion. And so that's why the humor that God has can put us a whole group of people together and we sing. And not all of us sing the same. Not all of us sound the same. My F is different than your F. Amen. And sometimes that's just the nature of it is. Sometimes we might as well just take an eraser and just erase the little deal that says what note it should be, because most of us aren't even paying attention. And so it's there that to bring the same thing, you know, I see they many times go down in the basement and they tune their instruments and they have never yet asked me to do that for them. And there's a reason, amen, because they want them to be tuned together. And so you look at that the Spirit that raised up Jesus, amen, must dwell in you and I to bring forth the exact same harmony, the same exact resonance, the same exact sound, the same voice, the same life. They must be the same material. Amen. That's why we can't sit here and say, I'm not worthy, I'm not worthy, I'm not worthy. God made you of the very nature and material that He is expressed in us, that we could stand here and bring forth the same praise. Amen. Bring the same worship, to bring forth the same word. Amen. It has to be the same material to bring forth the same word. Amen. Now, let's just turn here in Ephesians 2 tonight. Amen. 1 through 8, and catching this same theme here of being quickened. And you hath He quickened who were dead in trespass and sin. Because when you're dead in trespass and sin, you cannot resonate with the Word. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. So here again, children of disobedience put off an entirely different sound. Amen. There's no way that children of disobedience can bring forth the same sound as the bride of Christ. Amen. They have a different language. They have a different idea, different everything about it carries through. So it's no wonder that they have an entirely different approach. Now, my brother and sister, sounds a little harsh, maybe. Forgive me. But if you have a church that is of a mixed multitude, a mixed nature, the sound that will come, the resonance that comes from that church is going to be mixed. It cannot be pure. And so it's there. This is why the Holy Spirit, not trying to drive people from the church. Yeah. Amen. When Jesus went there in the tabernacle to deal with those people, my brother and sister, He didn't go in there just to hit them, to beat them with a whip, as it were, to run them out. But He was trying to purge the unsound from the church. He was trying to take away that was another sound, another nature, another essence. Because they did not resonate with the Word of God. They resonated with the denomination. They denominated with their thoughts, and their thoughts were their thoughts, not God's thoughts. And then they come, and as generations come, we find ourselves resonating with the thought of the church. And God said, I want your thoughts, although my thoughts are higher than your thoughts, I want your thoughts to be my thoughts. I want your life to be my life. Amen. Not another life. Amen. And so it's there among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. And were my nature the children of wrath, even as others. Oh, I love this. Amen. But God. Amen. Let's put a little pause in there. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Amen. Reminds me of a man I knew years ago. His children, they were traveling. His children would not quit fighting. And they kept saying, well, you know, they're pushing me. They're doing this. And I don't know what gave him this inspiration. But he decided if they want to fight, I'm going to get them close enough to fight. And he buckled them both in the same seatbelt. And it wasn't very long. They promised to behave so they could get to the place they didn't have to sit together. Amen. I think there's a purpose for God putting us together. Amen. Making us sit together in heavenly places. Sometimes I don't think it's punishment. Don't misunderstand me. But I tell you, sometimes God knows exactly what we need to bring us into a place. We need to sit down and rub shoulders sometimes with someone who's on fire. And then sometimes we need to sit down with someone that's got a word of wisdom or you know, a deep experience, a real prayer warrior. And God will set us down together and let us fellowship in just that little circle right there, and it's for our benefit. Amen. Now, oftentimes when we do that, we just pick those that we are happy to be with. We would just say, well, I got my four and no more. I got my little group. I got my little deal. No, my brother and sister, he didn't say here he was going to set you with your friends. He just said he was going to put you together in heavenly places. Amen. That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and not that not of ourselves. Right. It is the gift of God. Amen. Now, you know, sometimes maybe this wouldn't be just our children. But, you know, if we kind of are expecting a gift, I think it's just in our nature that we would express it like, well, if you're going to buy me something, I would really like this. And have you ever done that? None of you raise your hands? Yes, I was going to say, my, we need to have an altar call. It's our nature. We just have a desire that we would like, if you're going to buy me a gift, buy me this. And, you know, we approach God like that. Lord, if you're going to do something for me, I'd like you to do this. But is that wrong? I don't believe it is. We just need to make sure, as the scripture says, that our motives are pure. Amen. Because we oftentimes don't get because we don't ask. And then when we do ask, our thoughts are so convoluted that our asking is amiss from the Word of God. It's off of the Word and off of what God desires for us. And so, but by grace ye are saved through faith, that not of yourselves. So there's nothing we've done. God has come down. Can someone say, thank you, Lord, that you came and gave me one of the most beautiful gifts that could be given to mankind. Amen. Now, I just want to go into this here tonight. Just touch on this for a moment. In the voice of the sign, Brother Branham says, God never did deal with a group. Now, we're here as a group tonight, are we not? But God deals with each one of us separately. And none of us are facing the exact same trials or troubles or cares. You know, it's kind of like taking the stages of life. You know, there's a time that, you know, we set up many hours, you know, with crying babies, you know, that were sick. And you do that. And then there comes a stage of your life that your children get older. They don't tend to get as sick. Or if they are as sick, they deal with it a little bit different. And you know, the phases come. And then you come to the teenage years that you have to deal with teenagers. And those of you that have teenagers or close to having teenagers, I pray for you. Amen. Teenagers are God's revenge for our own teenage behavior. He just brings it back and lays it on us. But, you know, the lovely thing about teenagers is if you get in the right position with them, amen, I don't know that that's on the end of the SWAT stick or not, but you get in the right position with them. And really, teenagers, now, they might shake their heads up and down. I don't know here. I'm on thin ice, but they actually really want to hear the truth. They want things to be cut and dried. They want to actually please their parents. They actually want to do the right thing. So you look at this and realize that God doesn't deal with groups. He deals with individuals. Nowhere in the scripture he deals with one individual, because every man is different from the other. Every man, our thumbs are different. Kids, can you put your thumb up? Yeah? Our thumbs are different. Our noses are different, that's for sure. Amen. And our actions are different. He gets one man, he can get him perfectly in harmony till he can become that word.
Amen. That's right.
You see, he doesn't really care about the difference of noses and thumbs and fingers and thises and thats. What he's wanting to do is get us all together, and I abbreviated this very short, kind of cut it out of there for the sake of time. But he wants to bring us down into this harmony, into this place that literally we sound the same. He isn't trying to make all of our voices be exactly like we're some kind of mimic, but my brother and sister, he's bringing us all the same into the Word, and the Word is what sets that pattern and actually brings us into harmony. Amen. You know, it's kind of like this. If we want to be as a church in harmony, where we have friendship and family and fellowship within the body of believers, we don't want to be dysfunctional, we don't want to have all kinds of isms and schisms, then to do that, to accomplish that, we actually have to get in harmony with the Word first. Because we're humans, and if we're not in harmony with the Word, there's not a hope that we can be in harmony in the flesh. But if we get in harmony in the Word, in the moving of the Holy Spirit, amen, then as the prophet said here, he can get him perfectly in harmony till he can become that Word. Amen. If there's no harmony, we can say, oh, we've got the Holy Ghost, we've got the Holy Ghost. But if there's no harmony in the church, you'll have to wonder, what is the spirit that is bringing the dysfunction or the lack of harmony? And we need to get in harmony with the Word. It isn't, I'm going to go become friends with this brother, with this family, so that we can find some kind of harmony. It won't happen. But when we get, we, amen, can we say we together? We get in harmony with the Word, he'll bring harmony in families and churches.
Amen.
Amen. So sometimes we get just a little bit misguided on what we view as harmony. To bring a church that all likes just a certain kind of preaching or a certain kind of music or a certain kind of what? My brother and sister, that will be fleshly harmony, but it will not keep harmony in the church. But the Holy Spirit will. Amen. There is a perfect harmony in the Word of God. And I cut out for the sake of time tonight a couple quotes where Brother Branham's talking about heaven, talking about being in harmony. It's beautiful thoughts. Amen. Because you see, we're not here just to find harmony on the earth. This family with this family, this church with that church. We're here looking to have perfect harmony that allows us to step beyond the veil into the presence of God. That is the harmony we need. We can all quote the same quotes, read the same scriptures, but if there's no harmony with us, our harmony starts with Christ first.
Amen.
The Word resonates with us. Is that not true? Certainly, saints of grace, you're not here tonight because Paul's such a great preacher. You're not here tonight because there's nowhere else on earth you can live.
Right.
We believe we are led of God. We believe that God guides our footsteps and puts us in places. But we're here tonight because the Word resonates to us. And God, by His grace and mercy, brings the Word and makes it alive. And it's not just resonating to us, but it's resonating through us. Amen? So this sound is carrying through us. Amen? You know, the prophet of God talking about radio waves, how they pass through our body, how even those little elements of cancer pass through our body. My brother and sister, I tell you, it doesn't matter that it's passing through, because the Word of God, Christ in you, is not allowing those things to resonate with us. Amen? We're not attracted to that. It's not our hope. It's not our goal. It's not who we are. It's not what we even want to be. We resonate with the Word of God. And so as the Word comes to us and flows through us, amen, it brings a harmony that actually becomes us.
That's exactly right.
It's no longer like, well, I love everybody in the church. No, when you resonate with the Word, you are love.
That's right. Exactly right. Amen. That's right. That's right.
And when the Word resonates in us, we don't have to try to be. I need to be a living epistle read of all men today. No, when the Word is resonating through us, we just are living epistles. Amen. And when our life is so different than the rest of the world, then the rest of the world's going to read you. And imagine if you work in public, how many times that people have read your life and they might not care enough to ask you a question, but they know that person is different. Amen. Especially when you have neighbors on a fence on either side of you or something, there comes times you have opportunity to share the gospel. Amen. And so the harmony that becomes us must be the Word.
Amen.
Amen. It cannot be a church harmony.
No. That's
right. It cannot be a doctrinal harmony. It has to be Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Right. Now, in Christ, the mystery of God revealed. I love this. See, sometimes we pass over into these deep things, and we kind of forget, you know, the other part. We say, well, I'm justified and I'm moving on. But I think it behooves us to stop sometimes and just be reminded we are justified. It is though it never happened.
Amen.
I don't know who's burning logs in the basement, but it's hot in here. Justified in His sight. Why are we justified? Wouldn't that be, that's a great question, right? Why are we justified? Well, you see, just as if I never done it is a display of His victory.
That's exactly right.
Why are we justified? We are His victory. The church is His victory. We come forth in this last days with this glorious gospel showing His victory.
Amen.
Lord, help even Paul here. Amen. Just to wipe, as a brother told me once, why don't you just let your face know you're happy? Amen. But you look at this and realize sometimes the struggle of life does this to us. But see, we're coming. We are in this glorious gospel showing His victory. We should be able to stand no matter the circumstance and how we feel about it and say, you know what? I have victory.
Amen.
That victory's in me. I am
Amen.
Victory.
Amen.
Amen. So it's there when we see this. He died for this purpose, and we are proof of His victory.
Amen.
Amen. When we see Him coming down and living among the church.
Amen.
Now, what if we never saw Christ alive in the church? Would that mean the promise was not valid? No, see, there has to be somewhere He can show this victory, somewhere He can show this.
Amen.
And I say, thank you, Lord, that we can be those that He would show it through. Shows that He couldn't keep him. We see Him coming down, living among the church. That's His victory. Shows that He couldn't keep him in the grave. Neither can they keep us. Can someone say that
Amen.
With me? Neither can they keep us.
Amen.
That's right. We're bound right, and we're already potentially arise because we've raised from the dead. Unbelief in His Word, from denomination creeds to an eternal Word of eternal God, which is Him Himself working through us.
Amen.
See, now, if this Word wasn't going to be, how would you say, it wouldn't work, you know, as in failed, what would God even need us for? If there couldn't be a church with victory, then he wouldn't even need us. But there is a church that has victory. Amen. And that church, she becomes the very evidence that Christ is victorious.
Amen.
You realize, my brother and sister, the prophet of God places it this way, that God had to have a conduit to express his word to this fallen world. Amen. And he included us in that plan, that we should be able to be a testimony that people could look and say, there is something different. I believe there is a living God. You know, I preached on Enoch many years ago, just kind of an expansion of the thought of Enoch. And my brother and sister, Enoch was there in the midst of the same world in a relevant sense as Noah, and the very same unbelief, the very same factors that were there. And here's Enoch on his way to work. Amen. And you know, the neighbor that used to scoff at him comes out and says, Enoch, my baby girl is sick. Would you, I know I've made fun of you, Enoch, but she's very sick. Would you pray for her? And Enoch would be and go in there and pray for the little girl. And before he's even out of the house, the little girl's asking for something to eat or something of that nature. And you know, the people started to notice that Enoch was different. And he walked so close to God. Amen. He walked so close to God that the people were looking out and had a hard time separating Enoch from God. And that's what exactly happened to a prophet in our day. And that's why we don't agree with the Spirit. But many people thought that Brother Branham had to be the Messiah, had to be Jesus Christ in the flesh again, all kinds of things, because they saw a man walking so close to God that when they looked at him, they thought it was God, but they missed the revelation that God is going to do that with his bride. Amen. Not just a prophet, but a bride, a church, is going to walk so close to God that people are going to recognize them as something more than mortal flesh.
Amen.
Can we agree with that? Amen.
Amen.
Already potentially erased, because we're raised from the dead, unbelief in his word, from denominational creeds to an eternal word of the eternal God, which is him, himself, working through us, manifesting himself that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And if we ever fully grasp that, my brother and sister, there'll be nothing standing our way. We get a hold of that, amen, that absolutely as though Jesus Christ himself is walking on the earth in 2024, when we can grasp that and say, you know what, I'm on my road to Emmaus, but he's here. I'm over here hiding in my tree, but he's here. I'm over here sick. I got a child that's sick, but he's here. Amen. We'll never be stopped. We'll never be stymied. We'll never be turned from the path, because we know he is here.
Amen.
Amen. Manifesting himself that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And then the word moves on down into the body from the head.
Right.
What is it? This same word. Nothing can be added or
taken from it.
So that same word moves from the head.
Amen.
As the day comes close, and we are close.
Amen.
Down into the body.
Amen.
Vindicating that they are one.
Amen.
Oh, my brother and sister, this ought not be something where we have to stop and say, now, how do I fit in this message? How do I fit in this body of believers? Amen. He's come, and he's proving to us that he has actually come from the head. Down into the body.
Amen.
Vindicating that they are one.
Amen.
They are husband and wife.
Amen.
They are flesh of his flesh, word of his word, life of his life, spirit of his spirit. See? Amen. How do you know it? Bears the same record, the same fruit,
Amen.
The same word. See? Manifest Christ, same life, same God, same spirit, same word, same book. Amen. Same signs, things that I do, shall you also.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. My, notice the vindicated word in his body is his
Amen.
Very victory
Amen.
And the reason of his
Amen.
Death. See,
Amen.
Death, not in the spirit when he died. He only died in the flesh.
Amen.
His spirit went to hell, preached his souls in prison. That's right. His flesh only. died, then he raised up again and quickened it.
Amen.
My, look at how much quickening power there is in the Word.
Amen.
Amen. I was just reading a little deal. I have to really ponder this, but you know, Jesus actually raised himself from the dead by the spoken word.
Amen.
He didn't have to go leverage himself out of the grave. He already spoke it.
That's right.
3 days, I'll rise again. Now, how can we as a church, my brother and sister, grasp a hold of that? I'm going to use the word concept only to put it within a framework. We take this concept. How do we apply that to ourselves? Jesus didn't have to stop and say, now I hope what I've spoken actually works. I hope what I have spoken actually comes to pass. No, sir, he spoke it with confidence, knowing it was in the Word.
That's right.
And how's this bride going to take that position? Same exact way. My resurrection, my rapture, my overcoming has already been spoken.
Amen.
It's already coming to pass. Amen. Every victory I ever need in my life is already in me as a son of God.
Amen.
His flesh only died, raised up again, quickened it. Quickened means made alive. Think about it.
Amen.
Made alive.
Amen.
Christ is alive in this building tonight.
Amen.
Quickening power is right here.
Amen.
His flesh, which was his body, and that's the Word.
Amen.
It's been laying dead for years, but it gradually began to come in the Reformation. And now, I hope this makes you excited, she is standing upon her feet. This little bride is no longer just prostrated and buffeted and whatever, but the Word that started in the Reformation has brought a bride that is standing on her feet today, and she knows who she is and knows that the Word that has been spoken and the promise that is promised is being fulfilled. And she'll stand up and say, I might look like a ragtag little girl wiping floors in a kitchen for my cousins, but it doesn't matter. He's coming back. That's the promise of the hour. He's coming back, and he's redeemed me already.
Amen.
And it'll come to pass. Hallelujah. Don't you love the Lord?
Amen.
Just how nice. Now we look at this. When there is no direct connection. Now follow me. Might seem a little contrary. In a physical form, I have no direct connection to Jesus Christ. This man standing here cannot trace his bloodline naturally back to Christ.
That's right.
I was not in the original creation. Now bear with me, because some of these things might sound contradictory. I was not in him in the original creation.
Right.
But when there's no direct connection, but there is a vibration.
That's exactly right.
There is something moving.
That's right.
There is something that is taking place. And while there's no direct connection, you can have a vibration that directly influences everything around it. You know, you just, there's many, many examples. We were just on the way to church tonight. We passed down here one of these subdivisions, this old, probably about 56 Chevy Bel Air, all fixed up real nice. Here's this cool car we drive by. Sister Jerry's like, wow, looks like there must be a car show or something, you know, because this car was just so clean, so bright, so perfect looking. Drove up behind us at the stoplight over here. And just took me back to my childhood. We're sitting in our car with the blinker on, ready to turn to go to church, and our car is going boom, 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 boom. The vibration.
Yeah.
Now, I won't get into this because I don't want to just get lost, but my brother and sister, you see, when the prophet of God would take a hold of someone's hand, there was a direct connection to
right.
him. Taking their hand, right? He had their hand and that vibration come to him. But that was God, and there wasn't a necessary direct physical connection to God But God come down and used a conduit, and it read the vibrations that were there and that impulse that was there. Now, they recognize that now was a modern scientific medical field. They can measure the vibrations of different kinds of cancers. Amen. And they've got it all charted out now that literally they've proven it over when there's been, you know, confirmation medically of a certain kind of cancer. And they go and they take the vibrations of that and catch that electrical field there. And they can do that. And then they can actually clamp these things on people and say, oh, yep, you have this. And it's accurate. So see what God was doing. He was not off in the realm of the completely unknown and whatever. But he was in God's laboratory because God invited him into his laboratory, where he says that science broke in. So there's a lot of difference when it comes to that, to being invited in and being broke in. Amen. So you look here, resonance, the quality of a sound that stays loud, clear, and deep for a long time. That was that car. A quality that makes something personally meaningful or important to someone. A sound or vibration produced in one object that is caused by the sound or vibration to be produced in another.
Right. Exactly.
Amen. Now, think about this. We're here tonight, and I'm not trying to make this sound scientific, but I want you to just catch how that God works and all of these things tie together. Now, we're here tonight. What is the moving of the Holy Spirit? Is there some absolute physical contact that must come and touch you? But it's when the Spirit of God comes, the Holy Ghost, and it's resonating in the building, there is a presence and we feel it. Amen. And it affects us and we know that it's there and we can set our own selves. I believe we can be witnesses tonight to be able to say we have set many, many times and the presence of the Holy Spirit come and you feel it as though there is a literal presence walking up or sitting or whatever with you. You know it's there, my brother and sister, but there in essence, if you follow me, no physical contact to give you that feeling, if that's okay to you. That word, that presence that's there, the reaction of this body, it's reacting to a presence that's here, the Holy Ghost, Jesus Christ in the room with us. And we don't need a confirmation of somebody taking a picture. We don't need to have lights. We don't need to have these things because as the bride of Christ, we know who he is and we know he is here.
Amen.
Amen. And this is what sets us apart from part of the world that we live in today, my brother and sister, because they are there saying, oh, I felt an emotion. But when the music stops, their feeling stops. But when you have come in the presence of the Holy Ghost, when God is here with us, you get to walk out and carry that with you all the way home and even wake up the next morning with that same presence there with you. And you can rejoice in that without one drop of physical contact.
Amen.
It leaves something there with us. Now, we'll just take a moment. Brother Alex is going to play something for us. Our Lord Jesus, in the flesh, was no longer with us. But his presence,
amen,
is resonating.
Absolutely.
In us.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Look how the original sound, you might say, quieted and taken away. But when it's of the same material and the same, I don't know the proper words, frequency of that material, its ability to make that sound. You can take Jesus Christ in the flesh, take him away, it still resonates. You can take a prophet off the scene, take it off the scene, it's still resonating. Why? Because we are flesh of his flesh, bone of his bone, spirit of his spirit, nature of his nature. We are the very nature, life, and essence of Jesus Christ. And so people are saying we're looking for God, and they can't understand how you can sit here and say he's here, because they feel nothing, they hear nothing, they see nothing, my brother and sister. But because we are the very life and the very blood, the very bone of everything of our Lord Jesus Christ, it is there. And even though they can't see him, it's still resonating in us. The word is still speaking, the sound, the voice, it's all here, still present. And people say, well, the message is old-fashioned. Not for me. I'm hearing it every day in the same exact, what was that word? Frequency. I'm hearing it in the same frequency as it's always been to me from the very first moment I heard it right to this moment right here. You may say a prophet is gone and this is changed and that is changed, but it's the Holy Spirit resonating with us.
Amen.
That frequency that we as the bride can hear. Isn't that incredible?
Amen.
People are feeling like they need. What they need is to get in harmony with the Word. And then they'll find that the Word is still exactly
Amen.
The same.
Amen.
Yesterday,
yes, sir.
Today,
That's right.
and forever.
That's exactly right.
Sister Ruth, will you come, please?
Amen.
As we look at this, my brother and sister, we just realize that original word is just as alive today as it was then.
Absolutely.
And we say, thank you, Lord, that we can stand today. You know, I have a little bit of issue with my hearing in my left ear. And I say this in humor. So Sister Jerry convinced me I should go get my hearing checked out. And in the hearing booth or whatever, they did all these frequencies. And the hearing doctor says, you hear just fine. But you have a little something, I forget, you know, this certain frequency. Then he starts laughing. We caught the humor of it real quick. He says, it's the same frequency as your wife's voice. And... But you see, my brother and sister, while whatever it is, he said it's also people that work like I work, not just that, but even if Brother Sergey is driving down the freeway with his window down a lot, it'll affect that frequency there, that buffeting noise that's there. And it affects you, but yet in the right condition, you can hear just fine. And so because of a buffeting, because of something, you lose the ability to hear a certain frequency. See, Satan doesn't have to take all of our hearing ability. We can still say, Christ is our Savior. We can still say, He's our healer. But if we've lost the ability to hear directly from Him, I hope you follow me. Help us, Lord. Restore to me, Lord, everything that Satan would have tried to take away. Whatever frequency you speak in, Lord, I want to hear in that frequency. Amen. Everything that is done when the word resonates, I want to hear it. But not just hear it. I want it to be me. I want to be. Because you see, as they come, they take the one. It's now quieted. It's still there. And it's still real. And we still hear it. My sheep hear my voice. Amen. Aren't you glad to be a Christian tonight? Amen. Hallelujah. I know the master of the wind. 800, Brother Chris. I probably need some help, Brother Alex. Let's just stand, sing a song or two before we go. I trust that this had a little meaning to you. It just really struck me today. Brother Dace shared that, sent that to me, and as I listened to it again and again and again, I just got excited because it's like, hey man, you might take one off the scene, but you can't take what's in our heart. You can't take what's coming out of us and the sound that the bride will bring. Amen.
My boat of life sails on a troubled sea. Ever there's a wind in my sail, but my heavenly Father, He watches over me. When the breeze turns into a gale, I know the Master of the storm and make the sun to shine again. I know the Master of the wind. Sometimes I soar like an eagle in the sky. Among the peaks my soul can be found, but an unexpected storm may drive me from the heights. It may bring me low, but it can never bring me down.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
I know the Master of the storm and make the sun to shine again. I know the Master of the wind.
1013, 1013, amen. Key of F. Hallelujah.
Falling in love with Jesus, falling in love with Jesus, falling in love with Jesus is the best thing I've ever done. In His arms I feel protected, in His arms never disconnected, in His arms I feel protected, there's no place I'd rather be.
Let's sing that again, in His arms.
In His arms I feel protected, in His arms never disconnected, in His arms I feel protected, there's no place I'd rather be.
Amen. Earlier in the service, I thought of this song, number 128, If That Same Spirit. Amen. Maybe we can sing that.
If that same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwell in you, if that same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwell in you, it shall quicken your mortal body. If that Spirit dwell in you, it shall quicken your mortal body. If that Spirit dwell in you, oh, if that same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwell in you. If that same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwell in you, oh, it shall quicken your mortal body. If that Spirit dwell in you, and it shall quicken your mortal body. If that Spirit dwell in you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's sing number 18 as we dismiss on this last song.
All I want to do is love Him. So glad I feel His love for me. Jesus paid the price of redemption on the cross of Calvary. So every day my heart will praise Him. I know I'll never be the same. All I want to do is love Him, praise His holy name. And all I want to do love Him. So glad I feel His love for me. Jesus paid the price of redemption on the cross of Calvary. So every day my heart will praise Him. I know I'll never be the same. All I want to do is love Him, praise His holy name.
Amen. You're dismissed. God bless you.